subscribe to my channel and share my videos with others and watch as much of the videos as you can stand. And please feel free to comment. I love to engage with the community. Anyway, this is the first of the personal stories I'm going to tell you. And I've kind of a weird ASMR channel, you know, but so it is. This is my summer of 1969 story. One of my stories from that summer. I turned 18 years old in the summer of 69, and it was rather like, it was very similar to the Bryan Adams song, Summer of 69, as far as the band, the girlfriend, and things changing and all of that. So, I wanted to, after high school, I wanted to do something different between that and going to college, and I wanted to try radio, this radio announcing and DJing and all of that. So, I got my third class operator's permit, that's what it was called, issued by the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission in the United States. I got it on July the 23rd of 1969, and on there it gives my weight and my height, and I'm almost identical, the same weight and height as I was in the summer of 69. So, I went to take the test in Atlanta, Georgia, to a place, it was called the Merchandise Mart at that time on Peachtree Street. Restroom, and I left my ring on the sink. So I got all the way down to the street level and realized I didn't have my class ring. So I took the elevator all the way back up as fast as I could, trying to find the same restroom because they looked the same on every floor. I never did find it. Somebody picked it up. It cost $39.01. I still have the receipt. Okay. I never even got the benefit of wearing the ring because at the beginning of my senior year, I gave it to my girlfriend, Marsha. So, she kept it until the end of the senior year, my senior year. And then we kind of broke up, I guess. So I started wearing it again. And I went to take the test. Into the ring. So anyway, I found a job at the local radio station doing a top 40 show, top 40 rock and roll. But also on Sundays, I did a gospel show for like 2 or 3 hours Sunday morning. And then that afternoon, it cranked up into the top 40 rock music. That was kind of a weird dichotomy. Gospel music, and then after lunch playing rock and roll. So, at the time, I think I had a 66 Ford, a blue Mustang, and I was going to move to another town a little bit further north that had a small community college in a small town. But my car was broken down for some reason. City. And he was the 6 hours, I actually ran about a third of the station. DJ, a radio announcer, is a very glamorous job and you make a lot of money, but no, you don't make a lot of money at all. At least 90% of them don't. There's more to it than just spinning records, which we had turntables back then, left and a right turntable. It's coming back to me now. And you had this little cassette, like 8-track. I guess they were 8-tracks, I don't remember. And you popped them into the control, to the controls, and the little slot there to play commercials and public service announcements. You gave the weather and everything, and ran the news. But back then, you controlled your own board. You didn't have another person in another studio running everything for you. I don't know how it is now. I know it's that way at a lot of stations. There's someone else behind the control booth. Well, back then when I was in radio, you did everything yourself. If you had to go to the restroom, you had to time it during commercials or something. I loved it. So, I really didn't have much money back then. Better now. Back then I was really poor. And the other boy that was living in the old house, his name was Pete, and he said that he was a drummer for the Grassroots. The Grassroots was a famous band in the 60s, and maybe you know some of their songs like Midnight Confession. That was one of their big hits. I loved it. So, he was getting ready to leave the radio station. He was going somewhere else. He was reading the news one night, and he said, "We have no news." And he took the news, and he tore it into little pieces, and threw it in the back of him. Another memory is there was a lady who would call me real late at night, and she'd say, "Charlie, would you play me a Marty?" And that, of course, was Marty Robbins, who was a great country singer who died many years ago. Another interesting thing was the station that received promo records from record companies with the groups or the singers they wanted to promote, and we'd listen to them and decide which ones we did not like. And out in, we'd take all the records. There was a big pond in back of the station. The pond has been filled in since then. I saw it a year nice big pond, and we would take those 45s and those LP, those albums for your young people. Everything back then was on plastics, 45 records and albums, which were played at 33 and a third RPMs, revolutions per minute. So anyway, we'd take a box of these records, and we had a big collection of them, and we would stand at the back door and throw those things as far as we could, like frisbees, over that pond. The 45s would go real high, and we watched them, and they would fall slowly down, and they'd hit the pond and splash. The albums made a bigger splash, but you couldn't fly them as far, but they were very stable compared to the 45s. A lot of aerodynamics going on there. And I remember, too, also that it was just after there was the Beatles bonfire in some places in the United States. They had what they called Beatles bonfires. That's because John Lennon said something controversial about religion. So this radio station that I worked at sponsored a bonfire. And there was a picture of it hanging in the hallway. And I was a number one Beatles fan. And I went back and forth past that picture many times during the day. I don't remember ever getting upset or angry about it. It was just kind of funny to me. What else can I tell you? That was another DJ. I'm not using any real names there, but he had really bad eyesight. And he was trying to read the news one night. And then another DJ came in, not telling who that was either. The other DJ came in, and he said, "We have some late-breaking hot news." And he set the bottom of the news on fire that the first DJ was reading. Yes, he set it on fire. And we were all about the same age, 18, 19 years old. When the FCC gave us our licenses, I don't think that they had in mind people setting fire to the news. It was stupid. The sprinklers never came on. You know, nothing like that. And they put out the fire real fast. I couldn't believe what I was seeing. So, I enjoyed reading the news, though. And I recorded a couple of tapes of me reading the news. I still have those tapes. And I was reading the news about the Middle East. And I remember thinking, when I heard those tapes the last time, that you could have the same news report today, and it would be almost exactly identical to what I was reading 50 years ago. Nothing has really changed. So, I'd like to know if you had a summer job after high school, or did you have one during high school? What did you do? I want to know about these things. I'd love to hear what everybody's lives are. So anyway, this is Trip. I hope you'll continue to watch videos and subscribe, please. And peace out.